Hey everybody, Nick here, and today I got a review for you of this little guy right here. This is the Raven Watches Trekker 39. First off though, in the name of full disclosure, I want to thank Raven for sending this guy along. I reached out to them sometime way back, actually, and just said, hey, the Trekker looks really nice. Could I check one of those guys out? They said absolutely, but I sent them, as always, my full disclaimer. I told them I want to talk about the good, the great, the bad, the ugly. Might be a gem, might be junk. They did still send it along. Nonetheless, we have to assume this is the very best quality controlled one of these guys ever. And I'm doing my best not to let that affect the nature or quality of my review. Next thing, let's do some size measurement of this guy. The overall width of this guy is about 39 millimeters, as you might expect from Raven Trekker 39. Right, with the crown on there, closer to 43. The lug-to-lug distance, which is usually the most important measurement for people of slight wrists, is only 48.4 millimeters, which is actually quite, well, small. The overall thickness of this watch is about 13.2, but actually ends up feeling a little bit less so, because a lot of that thickness is actually at the top of this box crystal here. And so it ends up wearing a little bit thinner than that does, actually. And then finally, the lug width, so to speak, for wearing a swapping out your own bracelet appears to be a 20 millimeter lug. And so that is a beautiful thing. So next thing, this is the blue variant here. It's actually a little tricky to tell that at first, but I'm going to put a little bit of light on the subject from the side. What you're going to see here is that this dial is blue, flat out. This is not a black dial with a blue AR coating. It is just blue. And I think that's actually quite attractive. There are also black versions, as well as versions of the blue with date, etc. You can really head to their site and choose your own adventure, basically. But this particular one is the Trekker 39B4 No Date Stainless Polished Blue Dial. Polished meaning the second hand here is polished rather than yellow. And the price on this guy, it is $700, $750 if you order it after the pre-order period, whatever. So anyways, there you go. Let's go on ahead and jump into the good, the great, the bad, and the ugly of this little guy right here. So, on the good side, to start with, one thing you're going to notice down here at the bottom, and I'll zoom in a little bit, is this is 300 meter worth of water resistant. And that is great. That basically means you don't have to worry about water while you're wearing this watch. Appreciate that very, very much. Next thing, this has a very nice bracelet to it. The bracelet here, as we can see, is sort of a little bit of a Jubilee style bracelet with a little bit more of that, but it has a little bit of flex to it, actually. It's pretty comfortable. It wears very well. We can also see here our screw down links. Just using a flathead screwdriver, you can unscrew the link and put them back together, making this guy an absolute cinch to adjust. And that was, by the way, a pun. But it's a little different than the usual oyster-style bracelets that you're going to see on most watches out there, and I appreciate that very much. Next thing, this guy has drilled lugs. What I mean by that is there is a little hole right here which allows you to stick, for instance, a watch spring bar tool, like this little guy, through into there and disengage the spring bars. This allows you to change out the bracelet without trying to get in here and like try and get at that little bit of collar on there. No, this is just better. I understand for high-end dressy pieces maybe why they don't do it, but this should just be the norm, right? Drilled lugs are a beautiful thing. Next thing, this crystal here is sapphire, as one would demand at a price point like this, but it's good sapphire. It works well, and they've also got an internal anti-reflective coating that does some work for it, right? This comes very, very legible even with that, and so I appreciate that very, very much. Next thing, this guy has very nice finishing, generally speaking. It is not like a super fancy sort of finishing level. It's not trying for a super high-polished luxury tool aesthetic, but at the same time, it's just nicely done overall. The case has a very nice brushing to it. The crystal has nice polish to it. Overall, it's good, right? It's got some nice touches to it. Even the crown of it looks actually kind of nice, because you see here, that's the Raven logo right there. Quotha nevermore. Right, but they've done some really nice work here on the finishing overall. I do appreciate that. Next thing, this guy has a very nice movement in it. This is a Miyota 9015 in the date versions and a 90S5 in the no date versions like this guy. This doesn't show you the date, unlike the date versions, which have a date window down at the bottom there. And so that's a fine movement, right? It is a mechanical watch, which means it's using little spinning gears inside there rather than a battery and quartz crystal. It has a beat rate of 28,800. And it has hacking seconds, meaning that if I take this and I unscrew the crown here and I pull it out, The second hand stops. This allows you to actually set the second hand of the watch accurately, which is, well, good. You kind of want that, right? It has a 42-hour power reserve, which is fine. It'll stay running for 42 hours off the wrist. It keeps really good time. In my experience just wearing this, it has been accurate. Accurate to the extent that I haven't noticed any strong deviation in the week or so that I've... More than that, even. I bet Ward, it's good to go in terms of accuracy, and it winds very, very nicely. It does hand wind, and it has a nice feel to it. I appreciate that very much. And so I gotta say the movement here is very, very nice. I'm also appreciating the fact that you've got some options here. This is the no-date version, with no date window down here and the little numerals there, and I think I find that a little bit more attractive. Date windows can be very nice, but especially as I switch watches more often, it's actually a little bit nicer to have a no-date, because they're just quicker to set. Right? You just get it so it reads the right time and you're done. You don't have to worry about quick setting the date in either direction. So, you know what? It's nice that you got that choice. It's also nice that you got different colorways to choose from. I appreciate the amount of selection that they have on their website. It's something that a lot of brands do very, very poorly, but I feel like Raven has done a nice job of offering plenty of choices and especially even differences in features, which is good. Next thing, this is a very legible watch. What we can see here is it's very easy to tell what time it is. Just because you've got the two big hands, one of them is thicker than the other. It reads well. The second hand is very visible. The hour mark is very visible. And I'm going to charge this off camera with a powerful flashlight. What we see here is pretty excellent lume here. It is very, very strong lume on this guy. It works well, and the hands are also very well polished. So you can see that even without the lume, you can very often get the glint of some other light in the world off of your hands, so to speak, to see exactly what time it is. So I really like that. I think that the watch reads very, very well, and that's great. And so to me, the legibility is a beautiful thing. And finally, on the good side, honestly, they're trying. And that sounds really like damning by faint praise, but it isn't. There is many, 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 many micro brands going on right now that are, trying in various degrees, where at some level it's like, yeah, we made you a watch for $300. Shut up and like it. That's the common refrain, so to speak. Or, oh, hey, look, this is super exclusive, but it's not all that interesting, right? This really does feel like they're putting in the effort. All the things that they've done, by and large, have been great, with just two small exceptions that we'll talk about later. This is a company that is very clearly telling me, we actually give a damn and we're trying to make this work. And so I appreciate very much that they did. And so to me, at least, that's what's good here, is that they're really trying. It's super legible, with lots of options, a good movement, nice finishing, sapphire crystal, drilled lugs, nice bracelet, and 300 meters worth of water resistance. On the great side, to me, is the size of this thing. This is the Trekker 39, and honestly, in a world where we have so many gigantic freaking watches out there, this is the Omega Seamaster Professional 300. This is a much larger watch, right? And it's thicker, too. This is a very heavy watch. It is a very large watch. It's really nice to see micro brands putting a little bit of micro into things. Because right now, a lot of the big brands, especially the Swiss brands, but even the Japanese brands, are really all in on 43mm, 44mm, 48mm. And it's nice to be able to buy a watch that you don't have to be ridiculously, large as a human to wear, right? I've got a wrist that's about 6.5 inches. It's shrunk a little bit lately, and this wears just beautifully on me, right? It feels good. It's not too long, or it's not too tall. And as a result, it's also relatively lightweight. When you have a big, thick watch, it's going to be heavier, right? So I appreciate very much the size of this. This is just super wearable, and it's super legible. It's just really well done size-wise. And so to me, that's what's great here. This is the size that most watches should be, and I'm really looking forward to the fashion of 48 millimeters being no longer a thing anymore. Let's shrink the damn watches down and get back to the time when they were made functionally, right? So that to me is absolutely the great here. This size is just stellar. The bad side. One thing on the bad side is that the price is up there, right? This is a $700 watch. You are competing with some of Seiko's better stuff out there. And in fact, a lot of the micro brands in the world are coming in a little bit lower. This is fine. They have done a good job. And I don't feel like, again, with two small exceptions, I don't feel like they've cut any corners to get to a price point like that. They've earned it, but they can't let anything slip, right? They're not quite, because their thing is they're not doing a high, fancy, polished thing. Like this right here, this is the Manta Watch Noble. And this is a watch that is much pricier, but it is also much more fancy, much more polished. etc. A lot more of the, this is trying to be a high-end luxe watch, whereas this is trying to be a tool watch. And I worry that if they go too much further up the price scale, they might end up out of their element, grading something that's, well, not exactly great. So they've earned this price, but it is still a lot of money, and they definitely need to make sure that they're pressing on the value and fixing everything that they can to make sure that that stays a decent price. Next thing, this has a closed case back. On the back here, what I mean by that is, well, you can see here, this is closed. You see metal here rather than, for instance, the movement of the watch on the inside there. And given it may not be a super decorated movement, but still, it is nice to be able to see the internals of a mechanical watch. A lot of ways, that's one of the joys of mechanical watches, generally speaking, so not a big fan of that. Next thing, I don't love the fact that the blue dial they chose to do is a limited edition. I hate limited editions generally. I think it's a marketing tactic that is just ugly as heck, and especially, I mean, here it's aesthetic, right? It's not the case that, you know, everyone can buy a Raven Trekker. It's just if you want that dial, whatever, but guys, just make enough of them, right? Keep making them until people stop buying them, and we won't have this freaking problem. But I like the blue dial a lot, and I really dislike the fact that it ended up being limited. That just bugs me, generally speaking. Next thing, one of the few things that feels a little bit low effort on this guy is this top link right here. So we can see here, the bracelet is articulated. It's got that little bit of Jubilee-style thing. But then at the top here, they just kind of pressed in some lines. And you know what? It looks okay from a distance, but if you zoom in a little bit, and the line depth isn't necessarily consistent throughout, it seems to get shallower toward the top there. It just doesn't look great. I feel like they could have pressed those a lot harder and done a little bit better, or fused them in there or something like that. This is one little area where it definitely feels like they fell behind on the details. This just doesn't quite work for me up there. It's a nitpick, but it's $700. They are vulnerable to nitpicking, so to speak. Next thing, I definitely, this is also a painted dial. If we look at the dial here, what we see here is the only things that are on there that aren't, well, paint, the hands, right? Everything else is just lume paint on there. And that's fine. It means, though, that you're going to have, as opposed to, for instance, a watch like the Monte Noble here, which, given, is more than twice the price, but still, which has metal pieces that are applied to the dial there, and those are going to catch the light a little bit better and give you a little bit more low-light visibility. They've gotten around it by having good lume, and it's meant to be a tool-y watch, but at the same time, you know, that's one area where they have, it kind of feels like cutting a small corner there. Next thing, this little line right here. What we see here is, and I'm pointing to this bit right here, around the bezel here, there are different options. You can get a ceramic bezel or a steel bezel. I thought the steel bezel looked a little more different and unique. But what you can see here is that they're using the same bezel. They're just in putting a steel insert in. And look, that's fine, but it results in this line that doesn't really need to be there and feels a little bit kind of off, so to speak. Not the end of the world, but it's definitely a thing. Next thing, what we see here is this is a box sapphire crystal, meaning the crystal comes up a little bit higher than the edge of the dial there. That's fine, but it does make it a little bit more vulnerable, meaning that if I come at this with, you know, like a doorknob or something like that and hit right there, there is a chance of cracking the sapphire that's much stronger than if the crystal itself were recessed down below the bezel here. You know, it's not a big deal, and usually that's not a problem, but it's something that could be a problem and makes this a little bit less rough and tumble than maybe the aesthetic would overall show you. Then again, it's a mechanical watch. You shouldn't get too rough and tumble with it. Then finally, on the bad side, this guy has a clasp that is not amazing, right? I am a clasp snob. I believe that the clasp is, for wearability, usually the most important part of a watch, and this isn't bad, right? You've got micro-adjust holes, and in fact, you've got four of them, which is great, and you might even could have five if you drilled out another set, right? But at the same time, the clasp itself is held on just by spring tension here, which isn't necessarily amazing. And more importantly, it has absolutely no toolless quick adjust, meaning that for this to be workable, to adjust the length of the strap, you either need to take out links or you need to use a little tool like this to get in there and press that bit in. As opposed to on other watches, and again, this is not a super fair comparison because the Monte is much more expensive, where you can just take the watch off, change this, and then move this little bit around to shorten the bracelet. Or go this way and make the bracelet longer, right? That's a really good thing. And I think there are two kinds of people in the world. People who have had a toolless quick adjust and people who don't want a toolless quick adjust, right? It is such a nice detail that I would love to see it there. And the clasp on this honestly feels like the laziest thing. They've taken some steps. They've polished the side of it. It's thick, but this is definitely the area where if they said to me, Nick, where could we improve? right here in your clasp. You can do that a little bit better, and it will just be better. And it's honestly the only part of this watch that doesn't necessarily feel like $700. And given Seiko ships really bad clasps for $700, so they're still ahead of the competition. But still, I could definitely see going up a little bit more in this. I think that would make the watch just better. If they want to earn a higher price point, they're definitely going to need to address that, and probably going to need to address the little details. Like, there. But anyways, for the most part, though, completely, that's all the bad, right, is that it's got the clasp that's a little lazy relative to the rest of the watch. It's got the exposed crystal edges, which could be a problem in some hypothetical situations. It's got this line on the bezel. It's painted rather than applied indices. The top link isn't amazing. I don't love the blue dial. I'm sorry, I don't love the fact that the blue dial is limited. I love the blue dial. You can't freaking get one. the case back is closed. And $700 is a good chunk of change, but I don't feel like I think they've earned it, at the very least. So, to me, at least, that's the bad. On the ugly front, there's nothing ugly here, so let's go to the final conclusion. Actually, maybe the limited edition thing's a little ugly, but that's my bias. Final conclusion, this is actually a surprisingly great watch, right? When I reached out to him, I was like, hey, that's attractive, right? It looks like something that's going to be, you know, appealing to my viewership. It looks like something's going to be appealing to me personally. Like, yeah, it looks good. And you know what? In practice, I looked at the specs and on paper, like, yeah, great. Good water resistance. Good. And then I get it in hand. Like, hey, nice bracelet. Good drill lugs. Sapphire crystal. Nice finishing. Good movement. Clear legibility. Excellent size. All of those things are really, really good. Of course, it's not cheap. It's got the closed case back to it. They are playing the limited edition game. The top link isn't amazing. The indices are painted on. The bezel isn't one solid piece. The crystal's a bit exposed, and the clasp is definitely lazy. But the thing is, this turned out to be really nice, right? This is a watch that has spent a weird amount of time on my wrist. And I say weird because I am a human who switches watches a lot, right? When you have a large watch collection, you feel like an idiot if you don't wear them very often, right? Or I do, at least. And so as a result, normally I'm switching watches every day, every other day, something like that. This guy ended up spending about 2 weeks on my wrist. You know, I threw the Omega on at one point in time, and I think I had the Noble on at one point. But this has been a really, really good watch. It's just excellent because it's got that nice wearability on a smaller wrist. It's got a good weight, a good size, great legibility, all of those things, and with the accuracy and such, making this just a super solid everyday tool. And if you couple that with a very nice design, a price that's not cheap but feels pretty solid in the world of absurd Swiss watch pricing, it is really, really hard when I like a watch this damn much, when it's so easy to keep this on my wrist given all the heavy headers in my collection. Heavy hitters in my collection. There you go. That's the right sequence of vowels. Look, it is very hard to say this is anything other than a gem. This is a really, really nice watch. There are a couple of little places for improvement, but my overall impression is just like, wow. Okay, this is good. And this is really good. And this is a piece that I will have stick around. It is really excellent. The watch is very impressive, and it shows me that Raven is trying a good deal harder than a lot of the micro brands we're seeing out of there. They're dotting their T's and crossing their I's by and large. And this has absolutely put them on my list of, okay, I want to hear what's coming next. I am interested in this brand because this is really excellent. So if you're liking the look, if you can swing the price, then I think you should absolutely make the trek over to their site, because you too might end up raving about this little guy. Okay, anyways, hope this has been interesting to you, and that you have yourselves just an absolutely wonderful rest of your day. Bye now.